All right. So, what is the answer to yesterday's question about the classwork? Any suggestions? We have 40 participants at 8 o'clock. Thank you for joining. How do you do that? Or did you face any trouble? Using switch case, sure. What is the issue with that? You know the list of functions beforehand, then switch case. Right. So if you know the function, then you can do all of this. But it's difficult to do it in, at least I don't know of a good way of doing it for arbitrary functions. We'll see some way, but not in the general setting. So we'll see that why I have given that classwork. Okay, let's move ahead. So in general, the overall organization of the compiler looks like this, where there is a source program and that gets fed into the compiler, right? That is your GCC or Java C, etc. That compiler generates the target program, which often is a dot out in our setting. That a dot out can be given some input optionally, and it produces some output optionally. Right? This is the general flow of a compiler. We have also heard of an interpreter. It differs in this flow in the sense that the source program as well as the input are given together, in the sense that we do not really get to compilation of the source program. The source program as, let's say, .c file or some other source code is given directly as an input to the interpreter. There is no separate a dot out that gets built. Right? So, for example, your shell scripts or node.js, JavaScripts, etc. All of those we interpret. Right? There is no compilation. We don't create any .o or .exe file for our source programs. Right? So both by taking the input as well as the source program, the interpreter interprets the program and generates the output. And typically when we talk about an interpreter, we say that it executes the program line by line. Right? That is not the most precise way to define interpretation, but by and large for our purposes it suffices. Right? So it can work construct by construct, it can work block by block. Also, there is a possibility that the interpreters can compile the program internally. So that orange box that I'm showing as interpreter, that itself might have some sort of compilation happening before it gets executed. Right? So all of these are different variations. By the way, is anybody still facing the trouble with noise?
Yes, sir.
Oh, I see. Okay. Oh, yeah, there is some. Okay, so I'll not use the headphones. Okay, is this slightly better now?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so we'll try continuing with this a little bit. Yeah, let me know if that is also troublesome. I don't know what to do that though. All right, so we were talking about compiler and interpreter. And we have heard this, that the compiler compiles the program completely and then executes it, whereas interpreter does it line by line. But what is the implication of that? That is not always clear. So there are some things which get possible because of the interpretation, and some other things which are possible with compilation, not necessarily possible with interpreter. Right? So with interpreter, you can do something like this. So this is not C. Does anybody know what that language is? So we have $x and $y assigned value 0. Right? And then I ask for a variable name from the input. And then fgets from stdin gives me some string which is stored inside line. I trim that line, that is, I remove the white space, etc. And then what I do is very interesting here. This line is interesting. What it does is that dollar line, I take that as a string, right? So that gives me the variable name. At dollar of that, so let's say that I give the variable name as x as an input. So dollar of dollar line becomes dollar of x equal to 0. And therefore, I'll be able to assign the value to variable x in this program, given input as x. If I give input as y, then it gets assigned to y, and then I can print those values. If I give input as z, and z is not a variable defined in the program, in this particular language, it doesn't give an error. It just defines a new variable, and you go ahead. So what language is this? Bash. Okay, bash. Shell. Yeah, because of echo, probably you are thinking that this is bash. I think that is not bash. Yeah, it is PHP. Okay, so let's move ahead. So this is something which is interesting, and the reason why I asked that question about the functions is precisely because of this. This is kind of, in general, not possible in C, but possible in scripting languages such as Bash. You are right that in Bash, such a facility is possible, or PHP or JavaScript, etc. Yeah, there are extreme ways in which you can possibly do it in languages like C. For example, I can do something like this. So where I have hash include dev stdin, and that equal to 10, right? And then I print the value. So what is the output of this code? Any suggestions? Yeah, this looks a little odd, but like you can include any files, and almost everything in Linux is a file. Even the stdin is a file, and therefore you can hash include that in dev stdin. And what does that do? Can somebody suggest? Maybe assign 10 to x or y depending on input. Okay, so are you saying that when you run a dot out, you get the input variable name, and that is assigned the value 10? Is that what you are saying, Venkat? Okay. Any other suggestions? Yeah, Anirudh is saying during compile time, I think. Yes, so it actually happens at compile time, because the preprocessor needs to include all of this information at compile time. Right? So you can do such a thing that at compile time, while you run GCC filename.c, at that time the preprocessor stops. Preprocessor is the one who is expanding all the macros and including all the files. So that preprocessor stops, it waits for that input from the user. At that time you can type x or y, and that gets assigned the value x equal to 10 or y equal to 10. If you type z, then you will get a compile time error. So yeah, in an extreme way you can do all such things. At runtime there is no input that is asked for. So you can do such things. I just gave that example because they say everything is fair in love, war, and sea. Right? So, okay, we'll move ahead from here. In some cases, there is no, I mean, there is a combination of compiler and interpreter. And has anybody seen such a setup anywhere? Yeah.
combination of compilation and interpretation. Okay. So the combination occurs, yeah. So Cairo is suggesting that it happens in Java. So that is correct. Correct. Prashant has also suggested that. Yes, so it does happen in Java where you have a first compilation phase. So you have a .java program which gets compiled using Java C into a class object, which is an intermediate representation, also called as bytecode. And that bytecode is not executable in the sense that it's not something which is in the format which can be directly executed by the hardware. It is something at a higher level, although, so it is still at a higher level called as a stack machine format. And that gets interpreted at runtime. And if it is not machine executable directly, that means you need somebody else to understand what that bytecode is. And that somebody else is the Java virtual machine. So you need a runtime. You need a runtime execution environment to execute the bytecode, which is not the case for compiled languages like C, C++, where you don't need really a runtime environment. You have the executable and you just run it, and on the hardware you are able to run it. There is a little bit of execution environment which is supported by the operating system. But that alone is sufficient. You don't need a separate virtual machine or separate container to run the program. Right? So that kind of happens in the languages. Yeah, I think I missed this point. So there are some things which are possible with compilers, which are typically not possible with interpreters. For example, if you have a program like this, where you have a bunch of statements, I'm giving a very crude example, but you can imagine that these statements are interspersed across other statements. So all of these assignments to X can be equivalent to an optimized version of this code. And that optimized version is possible because the compiler is looking at multiple statements at a time, or a block of statements at a time, or even statements across different functions at the same time. So an interpreter may not be able to do it. By default, the way we understand it goes line by line. It is unable to understand it, unable to optimize the program in such a manner. Yeah, so this is what I was talking about in case of Java, where there is a source program. Then there is a translator, also called as compiler, which converts it into an intermediate format. That program is given to the execution environment or a virtual machine along with the input, and that produces the expected output. Any questions so far? All right, so let's go to the typical flow that we have in a compilation pass. Right? So the way we do is that we have a C program or a C++ program. We compile it using GCC and we get a dot out. But that is only at the higher level. There are intermediate stages through which it goes. And that we would like to understand as part of compiler design. So the first pass is called as a pre-processing, which is what we were discussing, that whatever your hash includes or comments, hash defines, all of those get converted. Right? The preprocessor in Linux environment is called CPP. Right? So this CPP is the actual program name, actual binary which exists. So you can run the command cpp file.c and that will give you the expected output, or gcc hyphen capital E is going to give you the pre-processed output. Then after the pre-processing is done, after all the files are brought into the same file, so you have hash include stdio.h or hash include string.h or your own file.h, all of these are there, then there are hash defines are replaced, so A converted to B. So all the instances of A are replaced by B. So all of this gets done by the preprocessor. Then you have the program in the same file. That file is given as an input to the actual compiler. So in this case, compiler means that you are converting from the source code into an intermediate representation. So that is called as GCC. That actually is the compilation pass, but that is capable of invoking the other binaries. So that gets converted into an assembly code. Well, it also goes through intermediate phases, but that we'll have to study a little later. So finally, that gets converted into an assembly code. And that assembly code can be, that assembly code is quite close to the hardware, and that can be converted into the final machine instructions in a binary form using the assembler. That assembler takes the assembly code, converts it into the binary form. Right? So that binary form is typically .o file. Right? Again, that is something which we don't see, but you can generate -c option of GCC, you will be able to generate that. Minus capital E option of GCC, you will be able to generate the preprocessed output, etc. And that .o file, along with the libraries that you require, that is the .a files or .so files that we have in Linux. So .a files are the statically linked libraries, right? So for example, libc.a, right? That is a statically linked library. .so files are dynamically linked libraries, which means that only the pointers to where the code exists are present in that in your program, and the shared object file .so is shared object that gets loaded at runtime depending upon where that path is stored, I mean depending upon what that path is, right? So that is done using LD. All your, even libc has a shared object file called libc.so. Many of our functions are dynamically loaded, which means that you can change the library at runtime. So there is a.out which is created, and then you change the code in your .so file and don't recompile a.out, and then you run a.out, the new functionality can be taken, right? So that is dynamically linked or dynamically loaded libraries. In case of statically linked libraries like .a, .a is called as archive. So in case of that, if you have a.out created using the .a file, then if you change the .a file, its effect is not visible to a.out, because a.out itself has brought in all the code corresponding to it. Whereas in .so, typically a pointer is only, pointer meaning only the path information is maintained about where that shared object. So there are advantages of this. Some of you who have knowledge of Windows, you might have come across the DLL files, which are essentially the dynamically loaded files, dynamically linked and loaded files. Okay, so we have this original program as source program, file.c. With preprocessed output, you get file.i. So that is the extension which you get. After GCC, you get file.s. And after assembly, you get file.o, and finally you get the a.o. So this is the flow in which actually when we run GCC, all of these steps get done. And you can get to any of these by using these commands. For example, so that is okay. For example, cpp, you can run file.c, and that prints the output to the screen. Then GCC hyphen capital S gives you the assembly code. You can run the assembler on the .s file. So these are the sequence of commands in which actually GCC is going to invoke all these commands. So you should be able to run these and get the executable even yourself. Right? You should try this out. Also, one of the important things that are useful things that you will find here is -v option, which is verbose option, which gives you essentially all the commands that it is running and whatever processing GCC is doing. Save temps is another option which saves all these files. So it does generate all these files when you do GCC, but it deletes it when it generates a total. But you can give it the option of save temps, and that will store all these files. You should definitely take a look at that to understand things better. Or maybe I just show you one small example. Right, so maybe I just increase. So let's say that there is some small program. There is #include stdio.h. And then I'm using my printf as hash defined just for the sake of example. Then I am doing my printf of something, and then this program essentially does not much, but it will convey to us what all happens, right? So when I try to compile it with GCC, okay, let's run it with CPP. This, it generates a large output. I would.
Sir, we cannot see the
direct 1.i, and that 1.i looks like.
So it, sir, we cannot see the screen where I
start like this, and there are lots of. So these are kind of comments. These hash ones are not comments, I would say, but these are ignorable lines, right? So it gives some additional information about what that program is at a meta level. This is not part of the program, in the sense that all of this is part of the compilation pass. This gets ignored with respect to the compilation. So this is not information which is going to be part of the executable. This gives additional information to the compiler. So we have this hash or hash pragma, which gives additional annotations to the compiler, which can give some additional information. So in this case, the information that it is giving is the line number, right? So in a particular line number, this file was included, and so on.
Sir.
So where is all of this information coming from?
Sir.
Oh, we cannot see the screen. Sorry. Okay, my apologies. Let me. Yeah, is the screen visible now? The code that is given?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay. So let me go through that again. So we have this program. So it has hash include stdio.h, and then there is a hash defined on myprintf. I'm just using that myprintf here, and the code does something to A and B. And when I try to compile it as CPP file name, that gives a bunch of output which I'm going to redirect to 1.i, and that 1.i is going to be like this. So hash 1, etc., these are all line number related. So you go to hash include stdio.h, so in that is at line number 1. Line number 1 of stdio.h will have something built in. That line number 1 will have command line. Command lines line number 31 will have something else. It will have usr include stdcpref.h, etc. So there is a nesting of information. It's not that nesting is happening here. That nesting has already happened in this file, right? It's just that information should be available. The reason being that, okay, what is the reason why the line number information should be there? Okay, so the line number information is typically there for error messages and for debugging purposes. Yes. Then all of this typedef unsigned characters. This is coming from stdio.h, and whatever is included in stdio.h. All of this is there, and you will not see any hash defines here. So this is a long file. I'll just go, and where is that? Our 1.c, that is at the bottom of this. So hash 4. Means that this particular main starts on line number 4, right? So of 1.c. So this is line number 4 int main, right? So it says that on line number 4 of 1.c, this code exists. And that is our code where that myprintf is replaced with printf. So I can compile it with gcc minus s. That .i file I'm compiling. Right. And let's see what it has generated. 1.s it should have generated. The assembly code will look something like this, where you have some information about some globals, including the string that is percent %d. That is a constant string. By the way, this is the code that you will have to generate as part of assignment 3. And then main is a label. So there is no notion of functions here. Everything is just code and of course data, but there is no notion of functions at the assembly level, at least not in x86 assembly. So you just define a label and you just jump to that, and from there you just jump back or return by popping certain address from the stack, and you come back to the original instruction, right? So that is how the functions get simulated. So there is some boilerplate code at the start of this, but our SP is essentially the stack pointer, which gets stored in the base pointer, and that is the one which we are going to use. So let me, so A equal to 10, that you can see from here. So sub Q 16 from RSP is making space for A and B, right? So there is 8 plus 8 bytes are allocated for the two variables. So therefore it is subtracting 16 from the stack pointer. Then I move the value 10 to minus 8 of RBP. So minus 8 of RBP must be the value, the variable A, because I'm assigning A equal to 10, right? Looks like there is this still 4-byte integer, but it is probably aligning at 16-byte boundary. So it is allocating 16 bytes, but it is using only 8 bytes. So this is very similar to how the padding works in case of structures, right? So that padding can happen even when you have variables. So that $10, so minus 8 of RBP is the variable A, and minus 4 of RBP is variable B, right, which we will encounter later. Minus 8 of RBP, which is the variable A, that is now stored in percent %EAX register, which is essentially an accumulator register. Then we add 2 to it, to that accumulator, because I want to do A plus 2. And that percent %EAX value, which is stored, that is A plus 2, is now stored in minus 4 of RBP, which is the variable B. So that is the statement B equal to A plus 2. Right, and then I move minus 4 of RBP to EAX, so that EAX is again going to be passed as a parameter because of B here, and then dot LC0 of RIP, which is going to be this. Dot LC0 is a label which defines this string, and therefore I need to pass that as a parameter to printf. So this LEA is the load effective address. So I load the address of that particular string and then pass it as a parameter along with the parameter as B, which is stored here in EAX, and so on. So before calling printf, I also assign value 0 or kind of clear the accumulator, because accumulator is the one which usually gets used in all the functions to do the temporary processing. There are again temporaries which will get created on the stack, but before that, this is a good practice to clear the EAX. All of this will go away if I try to optimize this program, right? So if this instruction is not really required, then that will go away. And then I call printf and then move the value 0 to EAX. Again, EAX gets used as an accumulator. And then leave, which means that whatever is the value in the accumulator, that is going to get returned to the caller, and so on. Right? So, I mean, this is just a brief overview of how the assembly language looks like. So, whatever you have done in RISC V, that those concepts are going to be very similar to how we use here. Although there will be some changes, because x86 is actually a CISC architecture as far as ISA is, the instruction set architecture is concerned. So you'll have to learn a little bit about this, but it's actually not that difficult. Once you get the hang of it, you'll be able to figure that out by the time we reach assignment 3. Okay, so that was assembly code, and then I can compile that assembly code. using as 1.s minus o a dot out. And when I run a dot out, oh, permission denied. Okay, what happened? Yeah, maybe let's see. GCC 1.s. Now does it work? Okay, so it prints the value to it. I don't know what happened with that AS. But anyway, so you can compile directly the pre-processed output or the assembly code. You can take the .o file and compile it, compile multiple .o object files into the same executable, etc. So all of this is possible. So your .o file, which we probably did not create. Yeah, maybe AS should have created that file. AS 1.s minus o 1.o. I'll just see if it creates 1.o. Yeah, maybe it created 1.o, which needs to be finally compiled to get a .o. Yeah, so that seems fine. So AS should have given .o file. .o file is not directly executable. Although it is a relocatable object code, it is not fully executable code in the sense that the library code, etc., is not linked in. For example, this printf is not there in that .o file, the definition of printf. Definition of printf is in possibly libc.a or some such file, which needs to be linked so that that code is available now in a.o, or at least pointer to it is available so that it can be loaded when a.o is run. Was that 16-bit boundary because of argc, argv? Oh, is it like that? Yeah, Rudra's question is that is it because of argc, argv that it will be a 16-bit boundary? Let's confirm that. I'm not sure. I'm going to change this to minus s. No, it doesn't seem to be, because it has it has increased the variables to from 16 to 32. So I think it was just padding. It was not really using that memory. Doesn't seem to be related to RCRB. RCRB has added 16 more values, although only 8 are again required. Right? Any other questions on this one? Okay, so let me stop sharing this part and go back to sharing the presentation. Okay. So why do we need padding? So why do we need padding in the structures? Abhinu? That will probably help us understand why do we need padding here. So we need padding in the structures because let's say that there is a character and an integer, and character is 1 byte, integer is 4 bytes. So the structure size should be 5 bytes, but typically it turns out to be 8 bytes and so on. So that is our padding, right? So the character takes actually, it doesn't take 4 bytes, but those 3 bytes are left unused. The advantage of that is that in some architectures such as x86, the byte bound, the word boundary is typically 4 bytes, right, depending upon the size of the integer. It could be 8 bytes on some architectures where you might actually have a padding of 7 bytes. So it becomes easier for the hardware, easier meaning faster for the hardware, to access a 4-byte boundary, right? So or 8-byte boundary depending upon the integer size. So therefore that padding gets inserted, right? You can have 1 byte for the character and then 4 bytes for the next integer. That is possible, and you can do that using some sort of, I think if you do a bit field of zero value, right? So there is some bit field colon zero, that is what you have in your structure. It stops the padding, and then you can have the integer at the odd boundary, right? So there is one character followed by 4 bytes. What the hardware needs to do internally is that it has to make 2 requests for 2 words, the first word and the second word, to access that integer. So the first word it extracts, removes the 3 bytes corresponding to the integer, and then it accesses the second word, which is again 4 bytes, removes that 1 byte for that integer, combines this, and then gives you the integer, right? So this is happening very fast in the hardware. We don't even come to know about it, but it is a penalty. In contrast, if you have the 4 byte boundary, it just needs to make 1 extraction and it will get it. So this is an efficiency concern, and similar concern occurs on the stack, where, I mean, stack is also a memory, and therefore if you have it aligned as 8 bytes, some of the operations that you can do faster, you might be able to do as the when you have the padding. In this case, it seems that the integer size is 4, so you would have not lost any efficiency, even if it would have been 4 byte aligned, because the word size seems to be 4. But still I think it has done some 8 byte boundary. It could be because that the GCC version might have been updated, and that might not be, and the hardware might still be slightly old, and therefore the GCC probably decided that by default I'm going to do 8 byte boundary and so on. So that could be one reason, but otherwise from the hardware perspective, you are not losing anything by having either 4 bytes or 8 bytes in this case. Does that make sense, Abhinav and others? Okay. Any other concerns, questions here? Okay, so we'll move ahead. So so you should definitely try this out. This will give you some glimpse of what all you are going to do, right? So again, as I had mentioned in one of the earlier classes, that the job of as a student of a particular course, you will find all these codes available, but the whole idea is that if required, you should be able to create it. So compilers are available, but the purpose we are studying compiler is that if required, you should be able to create a compiler. Earlier these used to be called as language translators. In fact, the course CS3300 was also called as language translators, and which includes not only the compiler but also some of the other parts of it which are related. For example, the preprocessor is also a translator. It gives you the hash include, hash defines, comments, etc., and all of that gets converted into a different form, right? So there is a translation happening from a program containing preprocessor directives to a program containing something else, right, which will not contain the preprocessor directives anyway. So it collects source programs, expands macros. These hash defines are also called as macros. And then the compilation pass, which is done by the compiler, it translates the source program into typically a low-level assembly. But the meaning of compiler has kind of evolved, and especially in the recent days, compiler is used as a translator for even from one source program to the other source program. For example, there are let's say you have a Python code and you want to convert it into a C program, right, or a Java program. Such kind of translations are also called as compilation. Or you have a sequential code and you want to convert it into parallel code, that is also called as a compilation, right? So there are these compilers available. Then there is a notion of domain specific compilers. For example, these compilers that we have, the programs that we can write are general purpose programs, but domain specific programs allow you to write codes only specific to a particular domain. The special purpose languages that we saw, the PostScript or the LaTeX or HTML, etc., these are in some sense domain specific languages, right? but there is something more to it. For example, you can have machine learning related algorithms, right, which you can embed in a particular, you can code in a particular language, which you are defining yourself for the machine learning algorithms. Or you have algebra specific languages, right? So you have linear algebra, you have matrix multiplication, or different kinds of matrix operations, and you define your language specifically for these matrices or linear algebra. That defines a domain specific language. You won't be able to do arbitrary programming in that, but whatever that particular domain programming you do, that you will be able to take advantage of, because you will have mnemonics, you will have constructs, you will have keywords specific to that linear algebra construct. C will not have linear algebra constructs, right? You will have to define it yourself. So that can be taken advantage of when it is part of the source code itself. The other language translator is assembler, which we saw, which converts the assembly code into the machine code. Then there is a linker, which you have this .o file, and that .o file is only corresponding to, let's say, 1.c or 2.c and so on individually, right? All of these can be put together to generate the final a.o. So there is resolving of references that is happening, which is essentially when I'm using printf or any other library calls, or even I can have my 1.c, my 2.c, and I can make references from one to another, right? So in object-oriented lab, for example, in one of the labs, we had make file being used, and there were multiple files. There was ADT in one, its implementation in another, and then there was main in yet another, and so on. So all of these were different .cpp files, which could be compiled separately using minus c option of GCC, and then these can be linked together to generate the final machine code. So this can be statically linked, or it can be dynamically loaded, so that leads to a loader. So both of these are sometimes combined. For example, the dynamic linking and loading is also a term that we use. So it loads the executables in memory and resolves the references dynamically. That is, at runtime, you will be able to load the .so object code and so on. Okay, any questions on this one so far? Okay, so one of the homeworks that I would suggest is to try these exercises 1.1.1 to 1.1.5 from ALSU's book, and that will probably help. Okay, so let's move ahead. So the overall organization of the compiler, now we are getting inside the so whatever we saw externally, that preprocessor, then the GCC, then the assembler, etc. So that we are going to split into different phases, and these different phases are actually different building blocks of compiler, which we are going to study as different parts of this course. So the first one is lexical analyzer. What it does is that you have this source program, which is a stream of bytes that gets converted into different words, right? So characters into words, those we'll call as tokens. That is the job of lexical analyzer. These tokens will be put together, and we'll try to make a construct out of it, a sentence out of it. So for example, I and F characters together forms if. That is the job of the lexical analyzer. Then opening parenthesis, then some other words coming into that, then closing parenthesis, then some other words, etc. All of this put together will define a construct. That is the job of the syntax analyzer. After having all this syntax analyzer, I need to do some sort of semantic analysis. What is the semantic analysis example? Any suggestions? So syntactically the program is correct, but there is some semantic error into it. What is an example of a semantic error? Type errors. Sure. So for example, if you have a string and I am doing plus onto the string in C, that is not allowed, right? So this is a type error. Your type is string, but you are performing a wrong operation, right? So that will lead to a type error. Unused variables is another semantic error, because you might have well, it's not an error, but at least a warning, where you have some variable which is not used, and syntactically the code is fine, but then you are not making use of a variable. Alternatively, I'm just flipping Raghu's suggestion on this. If you have an undeclared variable, you are making use of a variable, so that statement is syntactically correct, right? But that variable is not defined, right? So that is also a semantic error. Break should be inside a loop or a switch, right? So this is a requirement. If I put it inside an if block or arbitrary place, then that can lead to a semantic error. So syntactically, the program is, the construct is correct, but you can, but that is not a valid semantic action, right? So all of these are examples of semantic errors, and we'll see more as we go along. After a semantic analysis, we generate the intermediate code, right? Intermediate code is essentially an intermediate representation of the program, which is not very heavy at the source code level. The reason why we require intermediate code generator or intermediate code is because the syntax is quite arbitrary. If I give the same program to different students, they are going to write it in different ways at the syntax level. But at the intermediate code level, there might be a lot of commonality across them. So I don't want a very arbitrarily written programs, right? Even that is fine, but the constructs are really heavy in the sense that if statement can go from one block to 10, one statement to 10 statements, or zero statements to 10 statements, right? So this is too arbitrary to be analyzed. So I would like to split it into manageable blocks. That splitting is done at the as the intermediate code, so that the code becomes really manageable, right? After the intermediate code, yeah, so our character stream is the input to that, which gets converted into tokens, and tokens are formed using, so that syntax analyzer forms the construct out of it and generates something called as a tree or abstract syntax tree. On abstract syntax tree, I perform some analysis and again generate a syntax tree. So this is just a check to identify certain parts are valid or not. I get intermediate representation at the end of intermediate code generation. From here, the back end of the compiler starts. So from intermediate representation, I perform machine independent optimizations, right? Which are, for example, if I have to, let's say there is A equal to B and C equal to A, right? These two statements exist, A equal to B and C equal to A. So I can get rid of assignment to A and just write C equal to B if A is not used further. Right? This is a machine independent optimization. I don't have to know the machine related characteristic in it. So that happens here. After that, after the optimizations which are machine independent, I generate the code, which is the machine code. And that machine code can be further optimized using machine dependent optimizations, right? So machine dependent optimizations could be, for example, if you have A equal to A plus 1, and if the hardware supports an increment operation, in a special instruction to increment by 1, instead of add A 1, I can use something like increment A, right? So that could be machine dependent optimization which I can do. So all of this happens. Any questions on this block diagram? Okay. So all of these phases, across all the phases, we use a data structure called symbol table, which stores the information of all the variables, etc., their types, all the functions, their arguments. All of this is captured in this symbol table. And symbol table kind of evolves as you go from one phase of the compiler to another. This part is called front end. This part is traditionally called back end. So source program to IR is called front end, and IR to target machine code is called the back end. We'll stop here, and I'll give an example of all of this in the next slide in our next class. But any questions, we can have those here now. By the way, Dean has suggested that there should be attendance taken, right? So I don't have a good way of taking attendance. There have been some suggestions that you ask everybody to write in the chat box, and then the transcript that gets created that can have, there are some add-ons to Chrome, which can help you identify who are all logged into and so on, and for how long and so on. So I'm not going to try that unless the dean is going to force. For now, I'm not going to take attendance, but if required, then I'll have to take attendance in some or the other way. Okay, any quick questions on the logistics or whatever we have seen so far? All right, so we'll stop here. Tomorrow we are, no, not tomorrow. Today we are going to meet at 2 o'clock. We'll do some LexYak programming. We may not be able to cover all of 2 hours, 40 minutes, but we'll do some at least basic ones so that you get some idea to get started. So we'll meet at 2 o'clock. See you. There is a